Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents No BS Time Management for Entrepreneurs, the ultimate no-holds-barred kick-butt-take-no-prisoners guide to time productivity and sanity, by Dan S. Kennedy, narrated by Graham Rowat. Foreword by A.J. Mirabedini, CEO, GKIC, gkic.com. I'm a serial entrepreneur with years of experience running my own businesses, and most recently GKIC, the organization based on Dan Kennedy's business, marketing, life experiences, and teachings. When I first arrived at its Chicago HQ, I knew I had my hands full. I had to learn about the culture, the people, the members, and Dan Kennedy. I'd read several of Dan's marketing-related books, but I had not read No BS Time Management for Entrepreneurs. Why would I? After all, I had a long history of juggling multiple priorities, multiple companies, stables of clients, employees, three kids, marriage, and divorce. I certainly knew what time management was all about. But did I? Does this sound familiar? Wake up, and before anything else, grab your smartphone to catch up with the world. Check emails, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, CNN, ESPN. Before you know it, you've got your first text of the day, and you've barely gotten out of bed. You rush to the bathroom, with your phone. In the shower, you reflect on the email you should have waited to read until later. You wonder if your text has been answered. You multitask all the way to work, talking, texting, reading, maybe writing, maybe even Skyping, hopefully while being driven by somebody else or riding the train or subway. It's now just 8 a.m. The rest of the day is only more intense, and you and your time are spread thin. I can see your head nodding in agreement. We entrepreneurs are a time-starved group in a time-starved society. The entire day is spent in what Dan calls the maelstrom. At its end, there's not enough done. Stress. Failure. Guilt, too. Our children raising themselves. Our spouses having to make appointments with us and nag to get us to keep them. Vacations? Working. But with a drink in hand. My early days as the new CEO of GKIC were spent as I just described. I quickly noticed something very interesting and, at first, very annoying. I could not text, email, instant message, Skype, or even call Dan Kennedy, the man the entire business and membership organization revolved around. I had no idea what his favorite restaurant was, because he didn't post photos to Facebook of his veal piccata, or, for that matter, of his wife, their activities, or even the last harness horse race he drove in and won. Nothing. I had to fax him if I wanted to communicate. Fax? It was as though the man was inside a vault, closed from the world, and from me, the CEO. How could he? Why would he? Then I read No BS Time Management for Entrepreneurs. It was as if he had written the book for me. In his own No BS way, Dan shredded my flawed approach to time, showed me the holes in my life that bled time, and challenged me to take real control of my time. It was a game changer, and still is. Legions know of Dan's mastery of direct response advertising and marketing. Many know of his leadership in the field of information marketing. His entire No BS book series has earned enthusiastic praise from hundreds of thousands of readers worldwide. But what most overlook is that none of this would be possible without the discipline and structure he uses to manage his time. Dan creates year-long schedules cast in stone. He accounts for his minutes as the source of his wealth. He reads more than anyone I know, and he plays as much as anyone I know. His methods are unorthodox. He is a renegade. Yet he is not alone. In fact, an ever-growing number of our own GKIC members in a dizzying variety of businesses and professions adopt these methods to literally save their own lives by regaining their time. Being the CEO of GKIC is not an easy job, and I'm sure you don't have an easy job either. There is so much to do. But now I am able to do it and read more, father more, and take better care of my health. I'm recently married again, too. I'm frankly far from Dan Kennedy's level of time mastery, but I'm also far from the frenzied, stressed-out, time-starved CEO that I once was. I refer to sections of this book often and share the renegade wisdom with my associates, family, and friends. I'm confident you'll feel the same way. My mission is helping as many open-minded entrepreneurs as possible to get a lot more out of what they really want from their businesses and their lives. Getting you to take this book seriously is a good step in that direction. A.J. Mirabadini. A.J. Mirabadini has a diversified background in starting, developing, and assisting small businesses and mid-sized companies. He is the CEO of GKIC, the leading association of marketing-oriented entrepreneurs, business owners, and private practice professionals in the world. You can visit gkic.com. Preface. The author's preface, not to skip. Time under attack, as never before. It gets late early out here. Yogi Berra. It's a special kind of terrorism. The unrelenting, sometimes violent assault on your time, from all directions, every waking minute, even when you sleep. These desperate times demand extreme measures. Wimps, beware. This book is not for the faint of heart, fawningly polite, or desperate to be liked. It is, I hope, the hardest-nosed, most pugnacious, toughest-minded, most brass-ballsy and brass-knuckles material about the subject of time you have ever encountered. Hopefully you have picked this book because you are an entrepreneur, your time is incredibly valuable to you, and you are constantly running out of it. If you know me, then you've also been motivated to get this book to find out how I manage to do all that I do. I've been asked so often by what seems like everybody who becomes familiar with my life how the devil I fit it all in that I sat down and wrote out the answer, this book. If you don't know me, then your curiosity about my methods may be further piqued by the description of my activities that follow this preface. If you know me, skip that section. This question, how do you do everything you do? How is it possible? Has followed me around for about 40 years, is getting asked more frequently by more people, now more desperately as they find themselves more overwhelmed than ever, and my own proliferate productivity becomes more and more known. When I wrote the first edition of this book in 1996, my personal modus operandi was only a curiosity. Now it has become of urgent interest. For the record, I work in ongoing consulting relationships with 12 to 18 clients and, in addition, deliver between 30 and 40 consulting days a year, run a mastermind group that meets 3 times a year, accept about 10 speaking engagements a year, contribute to or entirely write 5 monthly newsletters, write or co-author 2 or 3 business books a year, and, as my main vocation, work as an advertising and marketing copywriter on at least 18 major 6-figure fee projects a year, 3 to 6 times par for most top-tier copywriters. I also have active business interests, manage an investment portfolio, and, on the side, own about 20 standard-bred racehorses and even drive as a professional in over 150 harness races a year. Recently, I squeezed in co-authoring 2 mystery novels. Oh, and I am managing to stay married. I do eat and sleep and take 4 to 5 vacations a year. One other thing. I manage my entire business life with 1 staff person, located at an office at the opposite end of the country that I never set foot in. We speak for 15 to 30 minutes most days and move work product back and forth once a week by FedEx. As a very busy, sometimes frantic, time-pressured entrepreneur, awash in opportunity, too often surrounded by nitwits and slower-than-molasses-pouring-uphill folk, I understand your needs, desires, and frustrations. The multiple demands on an entrepreneur's time are extraordinary. I'm here to tell you that you need to take extraordinary measures to match those demands. Measures so radical and extreme that others may question your sanity. This is no ordinary time management book for the desk-bound or the person doing just one job. This book is expressly for the wearer of many hats, the inventive, opportunistic entrepreneur who can't resist piling more and more responsibility onto his own shoulders, who has many more great ideas than time and resources to take advantage of them, and who runs, not walks, through each day. I'm you, and this is our book. As you have undoubtedly discovered, time is the most precious asset any entrepreneur possesses. Time to solve problems. Time to invent, create, think, and plan. Time to gather and assimilate information. Time to develop sales, marketing, management, and profit breakthroughs. Time to network. Probably not a day goes by that you don't shove something aside, sigh, and say to yourself, "If I could only find an extra hour to work on this, it'd make a huge difference in our business." I'm going to give you that extra hour. But what we're about to do here together is much bigger than just eking out an extra hour here or there. We're going to drastically re-engineer your entire relationship with time. I've had more than 40 years of high pressure, high wire without a net, entrepreneurial activity, starting, buying, developing, selling, succeeding in and failing in businesses, going broke, getting profoundly rich, and helping clients in hundreds of different fields. Here's what I've come to believe to be the single biggest secret of extraordinary personal, financial, and entrepreneurial success combined. The use or misuse, or abuse by others, of your time, the degree to which you achieve peak productivity, will determine your success. This book is about everything that can be done to achieve peak personal productivity. Since its first edition in 2004, then its second edition in 2013, I've only grown more certain in my convictions and more married to my methods, and this newest edition is more tough-minded than its predecessors. Just thinking about your time, really thinking about it, being hyper-aware of it, placing high value on it, is a big step in the right direction. Awareness helps a lot. There's a reason why you can't find a wall clock in a casino to save your life. Those folks stealing your money do not want you to be aware of the passing of time. And that tells you something useful right there. You want to be very aware, all the time, of the passing of time. It is to your advantage to be very conscious of the passage and usage of minutes and hours. Put a good, big, easily visible, nagging clock in every work area. If you spend a lot of time on the phone, have and use a timer. We'll talk later about psychological triggers. In my workplace, conference room, and office, in my home, there are dozens of clocks, including one that talks every hour. And I can't turn around anywhere in a circle without seeing one, nor can a visiting client. Facing me at my desk, there is also a hangman's noose. Not subtle. Beyond simple awareness, there are practical strategies, methods, procedures, and tools that the busiest, most pressured person can use to crowbar some breathing room into his schedule, to force others to cooperate with his exceptional needs, to squeeze just a bit more out of each day. In this book, I give you mine. You will undoubtedly be interested in some, disinterested in others, and maybe even deeply disturbed or antagonized by a few. That's okay, although it's generally a bad idea to hire an advice giver and then choose only the advice you like. In this case, it is a cafeteria, and you can pick and choose and still get value. Now, it is time to get to work. Dan S. Kennedy. Note. As I said, the original, first edition of this book was written and published in 2004. I have kept much of the prior editions of the book intact, or nearly intact, as they are just as valid as ever, and likely more important to you as you are operating your own business life now than they may be in my modified, late-in-career version. If anything, the passing of time has stiffened my resolve about safeguarding it, wisely investing it, enjoying it, and bringing wrath upon any who would steal it, waste it, or abuse it. The biggest thing that has changed since this book's first publication is the large and growing number of my own clients, GKIC members, and readers of prior editions who've adopted, many timidly, even fearfully and skeptically at first, the advice in this book and lived to be grateful for doing so. When I first wrote the book, I was more of a lone wolf, but today, thousands have adopted these methods and reported life-altering results. Some of their reports and comments are scattered throughout the book as encouragement for you. I will welcome your comments. You can fax me at 602-269-3113. No, you can't call me, nor do I accept email. You'll hear why in this book. For those unfamiliar with Dan Kennedy, a brief description of his motivations and militant safeguarding and control of his time, and a few of his most interesting procedures. For more than 20 years, Dan Kennedy traveled extensively, often exceeding 120 to 130 travel days a year, presenting as many as 70 speaking engagements and seminars annually. In addition, he consulted with numerous clients, ran as many as 4 businesses simultaneously, and employed as many as 42 people and as few as 1. He also wrote and had published at least 1 new book a year, wrote and saw published more than 100 other books, audio programs, and home study courses, wrote and published monthly newsletters the entire time, got involved in horse racing, and still took quite a few vacations every year. Presently, he maintains a slightly saner schedule, notably with substantially reduced travel. Still, he has a stable of private clients, direct coaching and peer advisory groups, and he spends one day every month telecoaching the same clients and groups. He writes direct response advertising copy for more than 24 clients a year, and has clients come to him for more than 30 consulting days a year. He writes 5 monthly newsletters, writes at least 1 book a year, and drives in harness races 2 or more nights a week almost every week. And he takes vacations. He takes no unscheduled incoming calls, does not own a cell phone, and stubbornly refuses to use email. He deals with the majority of his faxes and mail only once each week. Entrepreneurs have traveled from England, Australia, New Zealand, Japan, South Korea, Bahrain, Mexico, Argentina, Russia, Canada, and every nook and cranny of the United States and paid $2,000 to $5,000 each to attend his intensive, multi-day seminars on entrepreneurial success, in which the subject of time is always addressed. Kennedy is legendary within GKIC membership and clientele of thousands for his unusual modus operandi concerning time, and in this book, you get an inside look at the key strategies employed and the thinking of one of the most dedicated time and productivity managers to walk the earth. It is significant that Kennedy is no longer alone in utilizing these methods. In fact, he has inspired countless business owners and sales professionals to make radical changes in the way they control their time access and people around them. By taking control of my time, I've grown 1 orthodontic practice into 5 and created additional businesses, consulting with and coaching orthodontists all over the world on growing their practices. The principles presented in this book by Dan Kennedy can transform your life as they have mine. The most important benefit is focus. In this age of massive distraction, it takes extreme methods like these to maintain focus on what is really, truly important for the entrepreneur and the success and growth of a business. Dr. Dustin Burleson, TheBurlesonReport.com. Nothing is worth more than this day. Goethe. Chapter 1. How to Turn Time into Money. That which is not worth doing at all is not worth doing well. Warren Buffett. What is entrepreneurship if not the conversion of your knowledge, talent, guts, etc., through investment of your time into money? Starting with the very next chapter, we dive into very specific how-to strategies. But first, I think you'll find it useful to understand how I arrived at my philosophy of valuing time and how I value time. In time management books and in time management seminars, authors and speakers love to show off charts and graphs depicting the dollar value of each workday hour, depending on your income or the income you want to achieve. Maybe you've sat through one of these painful PowerPoint sessions before. You know, Mr. Lecturer up there, laptop computer wired into the overhead projector, lights dimmed, even a laser beam pointer in hand, so he can show off his beautiful 5-color bar graph. If you use his numbers, for example, based on 8-hour workdays, presuming 220 workdays, earning $200,000 a year requires that each hour be worth $113.64. Unfortunately, it's all a pile of seminar room BS. Here's why. It's all based on 8-hour workdays. 8 hours a day. But there's not a soul on the planet who gets in 8 productive hours a day. Not even close. You see, the workday hour is one thing. The productive hour, or what I call the billable hour, is another. In Chapter 4, there's a definition of productivity you may want to use to determine which of your hours are productive. If you can't or won't define it, you can't own it. If you don't own it, you won't achieve it. Now, if you happen to be an attorney, none of this matters. It seems lawyers bill out hours whether productive or not. Here's a joke. 35-year-old lawyer in perfect health suddenly drops dead. He gets to St. Peter at the gate and argues, "You guys screwed up. You pulled me up here early." St. Peter checks his clipboard and says, "No, sir, judging by your total billable hours, you're 113 years old and we're late." Lawyers. But the rest of us can only collect on genuinely productive hours. Can one number change your life? Let's go back to the math game and assume that $200,000 is your base earnings target. We'll talk more about what that term means later. How many of your hours will be productive, directly generating revenue? How many will be otherwise consumed? Commuting, filling out government paperwork, dealing with vendors, emptying the trash cans, I hope not, whatever. Let's say it is one-third productive, two-thirds other. That's pretty generous. One study of Fortune 500 CEOs revealed they averaged 28 productive minutes a day. The business legend Lee Iacocca, who made the Mustang happen at Ford and who rescued Chrysler from the brink of bankruptcy in the 1980s with minivans, cup holders, and bold warranties, personally told me he figured top CEOs might squeeze in 45 productive minutes per day. The rest of the day fighting off time-wasting BS like a frantic fellow futilely waving his arms at a swarm of angry bees on attack. And that was then. This is now, with all the intrusive communication, email, texts, expected participation in social media. All those distractions and the device in your hand. I have a lot more to say about this in the new Chapter 14, but let's generously label 33% of your time productive. With that, only 1 of 3 hours counts as billable. So you've got to multiply the $113.64 times 3, $340.92. This becomes your governing number for $200,000 a year. For $600,000 a year, 3 times that, $1,022.76. When I wrote the first edition of this book in 1996, I was charging about $3,500 to write an advertising campaign for a client. By the time I updated this book in 2013, that fee had multiplied 5 times. Today, a full campaign bills at $75,000 to $150,000 plus royalties. Since the time required is about the same, possibly less, as my memory bank of material and proficiency have grown, this puts more and more weight on any time wasted. I also now target a yearly income upwards from $1.5 million, so the ideas and methods I describe in this book are a lot more important to me financially today than they were in 1996 or in 2013. Of course, it's arguably true that I can more easily afford to repel some clients and annoy some people with these methods now than then, but I contend I got here, in part, by thinking about time in this fashion and doing these things long before I could ostensibly afford them. Anyway, let's roll back the calendar and assume that my base earnings target number required an hourly average of only $340.92. If you travel in business, you have to think about this a lot. I once lived in Arizona and then traveled for business constantly. I currently have homes in Ohio and in Virginia, grew to loathe travel, and now do it as little as possible, insisting that the clients, coaching groups, and even events I speak at occur at my home cities. But when I was traveling, if there were 2 days of travel bracketing a day of work, that put 3 days' cost to that work. Using the $340.92 hourly number, that's $8,182.08 of cost. Few people ever factor cost of their time or their staff's time into product, service, or deliverable cost, or the maintenance of each client of variable value or much of anything else. But you should. At just $340.92 an hour, a client who comes to you costs only for the hours he is there. A client you must drive an hour to visit and an hour to return from costs $683.84 more. If that's 4 times a year, one costs $2,735.36 more than the other. Consider 2 customers, each worth $3,000 a year. But one is needier and more demanding than the other. One consumes 8 hours, the other 3. The first may not even be worth having, particularly if there are enough of the second to be had. This, by the way, is why I book 20-minute, not 30-minute calls with my coaching clients. I can do 3 per hour at 20 minutes each, but only 3 per 1.5 hours at 30 minutes each. In a year, 10 minutes saved per month per client equals 2 hours. Times 20 clients, a full week. So again, let's say my number is $340.92, calendar rolled back. Here's how I have to use it. First, it has to be on my mind constantly. Is what I'm doing worth $340.92 an hour to do? I believe you need to be hyper-conscious of the disappearance of time by the minute or the hour, not in retrospect at the end of the week, month, or year, and hyper-conscious of the dollar value of what that time is disappearing into. Second, it puts a meter on others' consumption of my time. That unnecessary 12-minute phone conversation just cost $68.18, and the same goes with 12 minutes on Facebook or Twitter. This exercise forces you to think of time and activity in terms of investment and expense. It enables you to quantify what is going on in your life. About this, something of a discovery I've made in just the past 10 years. The more you think like an investor entrepreneur than just an entrepreneur, the better you do financially. It is investor think that makes you wealthy. If some activity, project, person, series of meetings, etc., is going to consume 40 hours in total, using the $340.92 number, you have to ask yourself, would I invest $13,636.80 in this as a venture? You also have to consider lost opportunity cost, meaning if I wasn't investing $340.92 or $13,636.80 of time in this, is there something else I could invest that time in more profitably? Third, for me, it sets the base cost for hours given to a speaking engagement, consulting assignment, copywriting assignment, and other things I do that are directly billable. And if you do anything but earn a fixed salary, you have to weigh this base cost against every activity to set your fee or to decide whether or not to bother. I've learned to think about time cost and time cost of travel a lot. When I first started shifting from going to clients to getting clients to travel to me, I used differential pricing. At that time, a consulting day billed at $8,300 if I came to you, but only $7,800 if you came to me. Why? Because it's worth money to me to stay home, be able to write for an hour in the morning before the consulting day, finish and be at home at 4:30, be able to drive in harness races and not miss any, sleep in my own bed, and be at work in my home office promptly at 7 a.m. the next morning versus losing that hour the day of, losing a half day or so to travel on either side. Gradually, I eliminated the differential pricing and simply mandated that clients travel to me. I finally converted to flying only by private jet, and that exorbitant expense to be absorbed by a client has pretty much ended any discussion of me coming to them. In a way, that expense added to fees has recreated differential pricing. The cost of even the client plus a couple staff people traveling commercial to me is a lot lower than my fee plus my private jet bill. Looked at side by side on a sheet of paper, it's dramatic if the client fails to factor in the dollar value of his and his staff's travel time, which most clients do not calculate. Differential pricing is useful for a variety of purposes. Within GKIC membership, there are a lot of lawyers, accountants, dentists, and others who charge a higher fee if they do a client's work than they do if they only supervise the work done by subordinates. You don't have to be flying the unfriendly skies to do travel time cost math. Many years ago, when I was in the field, selling, I quickly figured out that you could fit in 2, 3, 4, or 5 appointments per day, depending on how you routed yourself. A salesman half as good at selling as a competitor, but twice as good at efficiently routing himself and clustering prospects, makes the same amount of money. With this in mind, I've long clustered as much productive activity as possible, if traveling, or even when leaving the house. We'll talk more about that in Chapter 6. By not clustering, most people allow a great deal of inefficiency to sneak into their lives. By working at home, as a writer, consultant, and telecoach, as opposed to going to an office, I make a lot of money each day just by not commuting. I've conditioned myself to go directly from bed to shower to work in 15 minutes. If I were leaving the house to go to an office, I'd have those 15 minutes, plus another half hour, maybe an hour commute, then another 15 minutes getting settled in at the office, not to mention the commute at end of day, and the stops at Starbucks. I have nothing against Starbucks. At different times, I've owned the company's stock. If I'm at the mall, I might stop in for a cup. But the person who stops there every morning easily surrenders at least a half hour every day, 110 hours per work year, about 2 full work weeks to parking and standing in line. At the $340.92 per hour number, $37,501.20 has been spent plus the price of the coffee. Get a Keurig and buy Starbucks K-Cups and do something more valuable with those 2 weeks. Heck, even take a 2-week vacation. Almost anything beats this very expensive Starbucks habit. Seek leverage. In whatever ways you can, in your business, you need to seek leverage. In terms of work productivity, leverage is, in essence, the difference between the base cost for your hour and the amount of money you get for it or from it. One good way to evaluate your personal effectiveness is measuring and monitoring this differential, hour by hour, for a week. Now, let's set up your base earning target. Since you are your own boss, you write your own paycheck, and you decide how much that paycheck is going to be. For most entrepreneurs, the number is whatever's left. This is a huge mistake for 2 reasons. It indicates zero planning, and it means you pay yourself last, the number one reason entrepreneurs wind up broke. So let's reverse all that and start with the planning. You've got to decide how much money you're going to take out of your business or businesses this year in salary, perks, contributions to retirement plans, and so on. What is that number? I'll tell you this. 8 out of 10 entrepreneurs I ask cannot come up with this number. If you do not have a base income target, then you cannot calculate what your time must be worth, which means you cannot make good decisions about the investment of your time, which means you are not exercising any real control over your business or life at all. You are a wandering generality. Is that what you want to do? Just wander around and settle for whatever you get? Entrepreneurs should think about the purpose of business. A lot of business owners lose sight of that altogether. The purpose of a business is to make its owner rich. Time must be invested accordingly. Now, you may not have a situation that lends itself to clear-cut, billable hours as I do. So how can this strategy work for you? It has to. It's even more important to you than to me. Let's say you own 6 stores. Each store has a manager. Hey, this is complicated. Well, you'll have to decide how much of the business's bottom-line profit goal will be provided by the managers, whether you sleep or work, and how much is still inextricably linked to you. If you want $500,000 at the bottom line, and you figure half is dependent on you, you've got a $250,000 target. For me, it's reasonably precise. For you, it may not be such an exact science. But that's okay. I promise you that coming up with a number, even if it is arrived at through some pretty questionable calculations, is still a whole lot better than not having a number at all. Having a number is going to make such a dramatic change in so many of the decisions you make, habits you cultivate, and people you associate with, that the benefits will be so extraordinary it won't matter if the original method of getting to a number had a technical flaw or two buried in it. At least for the sake of our conversation, in this book, Get a Number, your base earnings target for the next full calendar year. Divide it by the number of workday hours. Multiply it to allow for unproductive versus productive hours. If you haven't a better estimate of that, use the 3x multiple I've used here. Now you have what your time is supposed to be worth per hour and divide it by 60 to see per minute. That little number may just change your life. It's sort of like a heart attack being required to really get somebody to change their eating and exercise habits. A lot of your decision-making gets easy with this number staring you in the face. It's hard to con yourself with this number confronting you. In fact, I suggest having it stare you in the face a lot until you internalize it. Write your number, blank dollars per hour, on a bunch of colorful 4x6-inch cards in bold black letters, and stick these cards up in places where you work, and we'll see them often. Generally speaking, 2 business life changes probably come to mind immediately, with this number confronting you. First, you realize that you've got to surround yourself with people who understand and respect the value of your time and behave accordingly. This is not easy, and they will forget often. Familiarity breeds contempt. Periodically, you will have to reorient them. You also must get people who do not respect the value of your time out of your business life. If you let people who do not understand and respect the value of your time hang around, you won't even have a fighting chance. Dan Kennedy's number one no BS time truth. If you don't know what your time is worth, you can't expect the world to know either. Second, you have to eliminate the need for doing or delegate those tasks and activities that just cannot and do not match up with the mandated value of your time. When I started in real estate, despite high ambition, I was constrained by the same 24 hours as everyone else. My early success came from a grueling schedule, long hours, and the high price of near burnout. In self-defense, I devised a system that featured direct marketing in place of traditional prospecting, plus a highly effective team with all the non-rainmaker tasks delegated to them. This took me to the top of the profession, twice number one in RE/MAX worldwide in commissions earned, and 15 years as one of the top agents, working less hours than most. While an active agent, I consistently sold over 500 homes a year, even while starting and developing a second business, training and coaching more millionaire agents than any other coach. Without the inspiration of Dan Kennedy's direct marketing methods and his extraordinary, extreme time management philosophy, these achievements simply would not have been possible. Leveraging yourself by media in place of manual labor and with other people is very intimidating to most real estate agents and to most small business people. It frankly is not easy to get right, but it is the quantum leap that uniquely and simultaneously lifts income and supports a great lifestyle. Craig Proctor, CraigProctor.com. The Amazing Power of Time Valuing. My longtime private client and friend, Craig Proctor, mentioned my time management philosophy. It can be boiled down to this: time valuing. Every one of my working hours has to be worth a certain amount of money. I do everything I can to create and protect that value, and anybody screwing that up had better watch out. Another related issue is project valuing, or opportunity valuing, or account valuing for salespeople. In short, a thing has to be worth X dollars, whatever you decide X must be, for you to even touch it, think about it, or be involved with it. Many of my best clients have adopted this idea and now have their own litmus test, helpful in quickly and decisively saying yay or nay to whatever comes along. Most sales professionals hang on to clients and accounts that consume far, far more time than they can ever be worth. Better to send them to a competitor. Most entrepreneurs perpetuate projects that consume far, far more time, theirs or employees, than they're worth. I've done it more times than I care to confess, but I'm getting much better at not doing it with each passing year. As a good reminder, my friend Lee Miltier, a top business performance coach, Miltier.com, and the host interviewer on my Renegade Millionaire System audio program, GKIC.com, gave me a wall plaque that reads, "There's an old joke of Bob Newhart's. An executive is engaged in mad, passionate sex with his secretary, clothes strewn about the office, she on her back on the desk, legs wrapped around him, he thrusting. She, overcome by the moment, screams, 'Kiss me, kiss me,' and he says, 'Geez, I shouldn't even be doing this.'" Dan's other business. It seemed like a good idea at the time, incorporated. Deciding what you shouldn't be doing, this moment or at all, is at least as important as deciding what to invest your time in. Disciplining yourself to say no is vital, yet very difficult for the true blue entrepreneur. Our conditioned response is summarized in reality TV entrepreneur Mark Burnett's book titled Jump In. Often, jumping in without every answer, without every needed resource, at inconvenient times, is what differentiates the entrepreneur from corporate drone or civilian, and what yields outsized success. This cannot be denied or discounted. Still, operating in an always yes mode, absent any restraint or discretion, moves past entrepreneurial to reckless. The week that I wrote this part of this book, I said no, candidly, after some weeks of procrastination, to two different promising opportunities brought to me by two people I like, respect, and would enjoy working with on the projects. Saying no was painful, not just because of the money that might have been made, but because emotionally, by conditioning, and philosophically, I prefer always jumping in. Admitting limitations makes me feel weak. Turning my back on opportunity makes me feel guilty. Disappointing good allies makes me anxious. Yet I knew that I did not have the bandwidth for these projects, having only recently entered into other time-demanding commitments. I knew that adding these would place me under considerable pressure and stress, and even though I am a stress camel, I'm also cognizant of each year's toll on that capacity. I do not want to be running as fast as I can and juggling as frantically as I can every waking minute. I've worked hard not to financially need to do so, so why still say yes as if I did? It's easy to be ruled by habituated reactions and behaviors that once served you well in the past, but no longer match your circumstances, needs, or desires. I have superpowers. You probably feel that you do too. Good. But making more time isn't one of them. Time, capacity, and bandwidth are facts. One chapter of Dan's No BS Time Management for Entrepreneurs literally changed my life, and did it almost overnight. The simple exercise in this chapter made me realize the real value of my time when I'm performing productive work. This was a huge aha moment for me. Of course, we all know our time has to be valuable. That wasn't a new idea for me, and I'm sure it won't be for you either. But the clarity this exercise created for me was new. Many things changed for me right then, not only in how I managed my time and work, but also the time and work of my employees in our busy, successful, but often stressed insurance agency. We had good people and good processes, but we had a lot of bad management of time. Pushed by this book, I focused on devoting the right shares of time to the most profitable processes and activities with the right people performing the right tasks and everything held financially accountable. I already had a very successful career and business. Guided by this book, I created a better career and a stronger business. Bill Goff, President, BGI Marketing, bgimarketing.com, number one training and coaching organization for all state insurance agents. Not being your own worst enemy. Success and productivity are not the same things, nor does maximum productivity necessarily translate to success. You might, for example, achieve a very high level of productivity at cold call prospecting and pushing through CEOs' doors in order to sell your services, but come to understand that you do not feel at all successful as a result. Instead, perpetually stressed and anxious, demeaned by the numbers game, the rejection, and the burnout, you might then come to realize you would have been better served devoting productive energy to building a marketing system that brought interested prospects to you. As you set out to get a far stronger grip on your time, to enhance your performance, it's important to be constantly assessing your reasons for doing so and the validity of the objectives you're pursuing and achieving. Entrepreneurs tend to be under more constant assault than executives or others, so it's easier to lose grip on the thread that leads through the muddle to the prize. Prizes you don't really want get set up in front of you by others, and you race to get them while losing the critical thinking that questions the appropriateness of the prize. This takes your time and invests it where it can't get a desirable return. Entrepreneurs are, by conditioned habit, often by ingrained compulsion, and perhaps even by nature, problem solvers and mountain climbers. It's what we do. But not every problem is one you need to solve or should care about solving. Not every mountain you are led to needs conquering by you. My racehorses are incapable of critical thinking. They are bred, trained, and conditioned nearly from birth to race. They are noble and fierce and automatic competitors. When I climb into the sulky and drive the horse to the track, get him moving behind the starting gate among the other horses, never, never, never does he stop and think, "Gee, maybe this is a race I don't need to run." But you and I are capable of such critical thinking. We can rein ourselves in. As entrepreneurs, we are automatic competitors, automatic problem solvers, automatic mountain climbers, but we are capable of overriding our automatic inclinations. If you put a business problem or opportunity in front of a true entrepreneur, he automatically leaps on it and begins solving it or capitalizing on it. He reacts as if a lion thrown a hunk of raw red meat. The lion will respond even if he has just had a big meal and is not hungry. The entrepreneur will respond even if he has more on his plate than he can handle, no need to respond, or no time to respond. In this way, entrepreneurs are dangerous to themselves. You can reduce that danger with more disciplined time management.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.